My name is Sandeep. I'm from Carrier, Senior Quality Engineer. So today I'm going to give you the training and how to operate the plant manager, basically. So in this total section, overall section, so you will have it two sections of training. One is a plant manager, which is responsible of all the equipment, including pumps, cooling tower, a chilled water system, you can say, chillers, as well as condenser pump and secondary pump. These are the things it's included in the plant manager. About the second section, you will have a training, dedicated training for the chiller. It's just related to the chiller. So these are the two sections. That will be the second section will be how to operate the chiller, how what to do in case of running in a manual mode, auto mode, and how the chiller will operate. These things will be explained in the second section. So first section, as a total plan, how you can operate and how you can control the system in automatic or in the manual mode. These things will be covered in the first section. So we have a certain, these are the topics we are going to cover today. First, about the Carrier chiller plant manager, manager, which a description of the equipments, what are the equipments we are going to cover on this training, or in what are the equipments are controlled to the plant manager. Second, explanation about the control schematic. The schematic means where you will have the sensors, what are the sensors out there, importance of the sensors, which is the critical sensors, which is the normal reading sensors. These things we are going to discuss on the second section. And the third section about the architecture, the how the equipments are connected to the plant manager, like about location of the EDCs and inputs, outputs, how the networking is done. About that section will be covered on the third section. And explanation of the sequence operation, how the system will work. Like there are different sections of it, like primary pump, condenser pump, cooling towers, chillers. So these are all things will be discussed about the sequence, how it will be added, how it will be subtracted, all those things. What are the parameters you can change, and when you are changing the parameters, what are the things to be considered? These things will be discussed on section 4. And then last section, it's a graphics, how we have designed, how we have customized as per your requirement. So that graphics I'm just going to show you, and what are the features are there, how you are going to control it, what are the options you can use it, how effectively you can make utilize of the our system. These are the things we are going to explain on the section 5. So overall the section, if you have any concerns or if you have any questions at any time, you can raise your concerns. There is no problem. I can give that. We can discuss on any on that particular topic. So I think it's clear, right?
Yes.
Okay. So can we proceed with the topics? Okay. So first, the equipment description. What are the equipments are there? How many equipments we have in our plant manager, and what are the equipment we are going to control it? So these are the list of the equipments. We have two chillers, water cooled chillers, three constant volume primary pumps, three condenser pumps, constant volume, two working, one standby, primary pump also two working, one standby, and two cooling towers. So these are the equipments we are going to control from the chiller plant manager. So these are the main critical, it's chiller plant manager means this is the main critical, all the equipments which is heart of your cooling system, it is controlled by our plant manager. So this is the schematic, control schematic. You can see how the sensors are located. So there are many sensors out there. So there is a key means temperature sensors. You can just locate you in some of the sensors, important sensors. Okay. So this is load. And across the load, there is a DP sensor is there, DP, differential pressure sensor, which will give the feedback of differential pressure from the load. And temperature sensors, there are five temperature sensors are there. This is in the load side, return temperature sensor, load return temperature sensor, chiller return temperature sensor, load side supply temperature, and chiller supply temperature, bypass line temperature. We have kept the flow meter, the provision, in the system is available, and temperatures, in and out temperature of all the chillers, as well as there is a temperature sensor across the common header of the condenser line. This is in the return, this is in the supply, and each cooling tower outlet will have supply temperature, individual cooling tower supply temperature. So as well as we have a motorized butterfly valve across the outlet of the chillers, for both the chillers, and as well as in the cooling tower, in and out of the cooling tower, you have motorized butterfly valves. So these are all the feed sensors, or you can say valves, what we have in the system. So there are important sensors. In this system, there are some critical sensors online. You should be always careful about that critical sensors. Some of the sensors, if it is not working, still the system will not have any issues. So it will work automatically. But some of the critical sensors, you should be very careful. The moment these sensors are disconnected, or this sensor, there is any malfunctioning, there is a malfunctioning of the complete plant. So you should be very careful with that sensors. The main sensor is load supply sensor. This is a very critical one. That is the one. So that is the one which will give, which will control complete system temperatures. So that always you have to maintain as a design temperature. There will be a certain temperature which is designed in your system, keeping in the mind actually. So normally it will be 6 degrees. So project specific temperature, maybe you will get it from the contractor or through the selection. So there is a chiller selection is 5.5. So this is a 5.5. Always you have to maintain in the supply temperature as a 5.5. This is always you have to maintain. This is the design one. I'll just tell you what is the importance of the design temperature. All your equipment like HUs, FCUs, everything is selected based on 5.5. If you are changing your set point, means you are deviating from your set point, means efficiency of the system will reduce. It doesn't mean that if you are increasing your temperature, you are reducing your energy consumption. No, it is not like that, basically. If you are using your system effectively, automatically the energy reduction will be there. I will tell you how it will work, basically. But you have to just make sure that you have to keep your supply temperature as a 5.5. That is the system design temperature. So if you are deviating from that one, means you have, that will impact on other way. There will be issue within your system. Maybe your system, you will not get a design temperatures like the area temperatures, or in the room temperature, whatever the selection or design is done. Like this thing, the room is designed for 22 degrees. If you are deviating from that one, you will not get a 22 degree here. Maybe you will get 22 degree instead of within 5 minutes, it will actually, this FCU will actually within 5 minutes with 22 degree. If you are deviating from, maybe you can get 7 degree. So this will take maybe 15 or 20 minutes, then only this room will achieve that 22 degree, the design temperature of this room. So this is what the consequences you will give when you are deviating from the set points. So make sure that you are maintaining your design temperature in the system.
But if we are not, because we will cool all the building, we will not shut down anything. So since everything is running continuously, if this set point is higher, nothing will change. It's only the consumption of the chill.
No, it's not. If you continuously are running your system, so the moment if the temperature is maintained in this room, means automatically your valve will close. This AC valve will close. So this FC valve is closed, means automatically your secondary pump speed will reduce. If your valves are working properly, secondary pump speed will reduce. The moment the secondary pump speed is reduced, means there is some actions will take place inside the plant that we are going to discuss in the second section of that. So automatically chiller will reduce its capacity, or if you don't need to run the second chiller, automatically the second chiller will switch off, only one chiller will be working and it will maintain the temperature. Okay.
Not based on the flow.
That's right.
Not based on the attempt of the chiller to reach the 5.5 or to reach 8.
No, it's both or vice versa. If you're reducing the flow, automatically your temperature, you're maintaining your temperature, 5.5 degree at any time you're maintaining. You are maintaining the, reducing the flow means you can reduce your capacity. Maybe it's running in 60%, if you reduce around 10%, automatically the 10% of the capacity will be reduced. So automatically it will be impacted on your system.
But if I need 60% to reach the 5.5, perhaps I need 50% to reach 8.5.
No, listen, what will happen, I will tell you. Okay, so this room is not occupied. So you are maintaining the temperature. There is, the next room, maybe it's fully occupied. So you have to maintain the 22 temperature there. So now you are giving the 7 degree of that room. The AC is running in the full speed. So to maintain that heat load of that particular room, you have to provide a 5.5 degree. If you are maintaining a 7 degree of your supply temperature, it will never achieve your, with the full heat load of that room, the occupants, it will never maintain the 22. Instead of maintaining 22, it will maintain 24. Because you are not giving the design temperature of that unit. This is the consequences you will get. Maybe you will say here, but you cannot maintain the comfort in the next room or other place where the occupied the rooms. So that is the what it will happen. We are going to discuss on that particular things. I will explain you what is the importance. The main thing it will take, there is a bypass line. So this line. This is the line which will balance the system basically. So very critical line with that one. We will going to discuss about that one, then you will come to understand how the flow will react based on your load. Okay, that is the one. And second is chiller return. This is called load supply temperature, and there is a return temperature. This is the one. This is also very important, very critical temperature, which will give exactly what is your chiller return temperature, which will be utilized or which will be monitored in the system. To find out how your system is behaving. So that is a very critical one. Second, supply temperature of cooling tower. Supply temperature of cooling tower, that is a very important common heater. That will give the exact temperature, required temperature for the chillers to maintain the temperatures. That's a very critical. So these are the three critical temperature sensors which is must in the system. So if anything happens with sensors, you should take immediate action to run the system to maintain the system in the best condition, in auto mode. So control schematic. Any doubts or any questions? So next section, system architecture. This is how the network is designed, to how we can interface all the equipments to the DDC controllers. We take on all the signals to the DDC controllers, and then this will be information will be shared with the gateways, and gateway will give the information to the front end, the computer. So we have two chillers, so chiller 1, chiller 2, which is connected through a communication cable, and we have a gateway. So all the information, chiller information, will be taken through the to the software communication, through the integration to the gateway, and that information will be shared throughout the system. So we have three DDC controllers here. One DDC is for dedicated for primary pump and chillers, and second one is condenser pumps and cooling towers, and there is a one more DDC-3 is responsible for secondary pump. So this DDC dedicated to that particular equipment, all the actions or all the monitoring will happen through that particular DDC, and that information shared all over the network. So these are the DDCs, and all these DDCs are connected to the dedicated gateways. They have dedicated gateways which will convert to a backend over IP protocol, and that information is connected to the front end. So front end, you have a carrier software through that software you can monitor, you can control, you can change your parameters, all the actions can you can take you can do whatever the required controlled through that PC. So this is about the system architecture. So we are using here, just for your information, we are using three protocols totally. One is carrier proprietary protocol, which is called CCN protocol. And second one is, which is using the open protocol, BACnet over ARPNet, which through the DDCs will communicate. And there is a main, the protocol, which is management level, that is BACnet over IP. Through the BACnet over IP, we are interfacing with our PC. So this is about the system architecture. It's clear. Okay, we are going for the next slide. Now comes a sequence operation. So how the system will work, individual equipments will work, in what conditions all considered to adding the chiller or subtracting the chiller, how what are the parameters are considered to add the chiller or subtract the chiller. These are the things we are going to discuss about in this section. So we have the wiring layout, just I explained you, we are using a CCN carrier proprietary communication protocol. We have connected all the chillers through a looping cable, two core cable, and it is connected to the gateway. So through this protocol, we can access complete chiller, or you can monitor or you can control from the front end. This is about the layout of the wiring and changeover. All the equipments, its changeover is 1 week. Every week, once the changeover will take place, that maybe the pumps or chillers, cooling towers, everything. And these timings we can define in the system, which time and what time you can change. So we can select a weekdays, which is you have a less load or your operator is available and that particular day. Important thing is whenever rotation happens, somebody should be there. The operator should be there near to the PC to monitor how the changeover is going to happen. Changeover means there is a mechanical changeover. Mechanical things will move. So maybe you will have an alarm or there is something, maybe it will sometimes it will trip. So maybe. So in that stage, it is very important some operator should be there in the system. That is why we given a option to define whenever you will available or whenever you are free. So that time you can put that timings and that time the system will rotate each or each set of equipment. So that is about the rotation. And rotation, three things will happen. Once when there is a weekly rotation or in any failure of the equipments or chiller or primary pump, that particular set of equipments changeover will take place. If any of the equipment trips, that is that time also the changeover takes place. So this is about the changeover. Now we are going to have two important, you can say the process which will take place. That is starting and shutting down of the chillers. So how the system will start up and how the system will shut down. This is the most important. Step by step it will happen. And how will this happen? We are going to discuss. I'm going to explain on this particular session. So startup sequence. There are before that I wanted to just tell you there are. It's not only the auto system. There is a semi auto system also, the part of the plant manager. So it's not like, you know, you want to change in emergencies, you have some problem issues, or you want to run the chiller in the manual. So you want to run the manual, it doesn't mean that go put all the equipment in the manual. No need actually. If you want to run chiller manual mode, go to the chiller, select the chiller, switch on the chiller, that's it. Rest of the things, it's all the things the plant manager will take care of that actions. For example, opening the valves, running the primary pump, running the condenser pump, running the cooling tower, automatically it will done. It is not like that, go everything, you put it on first, open the valves, switch on all the equipment in the manual, and then you run it. This doesn't require actually in this system. That is why I'm telling you, it's automatic and semi-automatic. Both, keeping in the mind, we have designed the system. A factory has designed the system. That's why you can see some of the sequences, it's not like, you know, standard sequences. There are some of the sequences, with, like for example, the valves. Valves are not usually, it's controlled by the, like BMS guys, you can see, or there is a plant manager. No, in this case, valves are not controlled by us. Valves are controlled by the chiller itself. You give the command to the chiller will request automatically to the valves to open. These are the things, some of the changes, it is there in our system. So for example, when you start the system, now for example, we assume that all the system is off, complete system, you went and you switched on the plant from the PC. how to switch on that plant from the PC, I'll just explain you in the coming slides. But in this, you trigger the plant enable command. The moment you trigger the plant enable command, first the system will check healthiness of the each equipment. For example, chillers, primary pumps, condenser pump, cooling tower. It will first check the healthiness of the equipment. Based on your healthiness of the equipment, it will select which should be the lead one. There is a weekly rotation will be there. Weekly rotation, it will decide like if chiller 1 is the first, chiller 2 is the second one, the lead and lag. So maybe you have an issue with the chiller 1. When you switch on the plant, it will check healthiness. There is an issue is there, so it will disable the chiller 1. It will give the command to the, it will select the second chiller as a lead chiller. That is, it will happen the first stage. So once the healthiness of the system is checked, and then immediately it will select that healthy chiller, and it will give the command. First thing is, it will give the command directly to the chiller. It's not like that it will give the command to the cooling tower or butterfly valve. No, it is not going to do that one. It will give the command to the chiller. In chiller, there are two things. One is plant manager, that is the external control. There is an internal controller, control is there, which is chiller own microprocessor. If I give the command, then once again chiller itself, it will check internal safety circuits as well as internal the healthiness of the chiller. If the chiller is healthy and we can run that chiller without any issues, chiller will accept my command. If there is any issue with the chillers, immediately it will give a alert or alarm. In chiller also, there is two things are there. One is alarm, alert. This is very important. The moment comes alarm, that's it. The chiller will goes off. You cannot run that chiller till you rectify that alarm. There is an alarm just before the alarm, or there is any minor issues with the chillers, but still the chiller can run. In that condition, it will give as an alert. The alert means you have to go and attend that particular the alert or issue. The moment if you are not attending that particular issue or alert, it will maybe it will automatically it will check itself and it will control or it will eliminate that particular alert. If it cannot eliminate that particular alert, it will convert into alarm. The moment it comes alarm, that's it, the chiller goes off. So this is a very important two things always you have to remember. Two types of chiller feedbacks over here. So if the chiller is healthy, chiller will give it a trigger for the butterfly valve opening. So it will give the command to the butterfly valve.
How long does it take from the moment the chiller gets a command to start?
It's 2 to 3 minutes. It's 2 to 3 minutes.
Two to three minutes.
It's not a fixed one. It depends upon the chiller healthiness. Maybe it will go for a 4 minute also. But maximum within 5 minutes it will take actions. It will give you a reply for, it will give the command to the butterfly valves, or it will give the reply itself saying that there is an issue. It will give the alarm indication. So we will first give the command to the chiller. Chiller will give the feedback that I am running. It will give the feedback to us as a running indication that I am running. Means it's ready to, it doesn't mean that chiller is started, but it is mean that chiller is ready to start. It's ready to start. So once we get a indication chiller from the chiller ready to start, so automatically the valves will open, the condenser valves and chill water side valves. These two evaporator side valves, it will start to open. That is the first action it will happen from the chiller. Once it's open, the status, we will receive the status of the condenser valve or evaporator valves from the valves, and then it will trigger primary pump. It will run the primary pump, but still the condenser pump will not run, but primary pump will run because only it is interlocked with the evaporator valves. Okay. The second, third action, upon the receiving the feedback from the condenser side of butterfly valve, it will give the immediately command to the cooling tower butterfly valves. There is in and out cooling tower butterfly valves are there. Immediately, it's parallel basically, you can see condenser valves and cooling tower valves. It both will trigger parallel basically. So once the opening, the feedback of this condenser valve as well as cooling tower valves, once we receive, immediately the DDC will give the command to the cooling tower fan to run. That is what will happen in the fourth session, fourth one. And then once the cooling tower fans are run, immediately the condenser pumps also, it will run basically in that parallel. So butterfly valves, that is the fifth one. But it will check before running the condenser valve, it will, the condenser pump, it will check the condenser butterfly valve status as well as cooling tower valve status. If all the valves are open, immediately the condenser pump will start. So once all these stages are complete, the stage by stage, like running, opening the valves, running the primary pump, running the condenser pump, running the cooling towers, so everything is goes as per the sequence, then the flow chiller itself, it will check the, for the flow. It's in the condenser line as well as in the chill water line. If the flow is established, immediately chiller will start it to loading process. It will take, it will start it to increase its flows. That is the starting of the chillers. So if there is any of this steps or this process, if we have issues, immediately it will trigger as alarm, and that particular action which is not taken place, and it will give the indication to the operator that there is some malfunctioning has happened, and maybe if the second equipment is available, it will change over to the healthy equipment, next available equipment. This is about the startup of the system. So first,
So in total, how long it will take?
It will take 5 to 6 minutes. It's maximum 5 to 6 minutes. Depends, maximum it will take 5 minutes. This complete process.
The whole process.
That's right.
Including the chiller, the self-check, and the butterfly.
Minimum it will take 3 minutes for this process. Maximum it will take 5 minutes. Within 5 minutes, you will start the chiller, started to, if chiller is healthy.
Yeah.
Or all the equipments are healthy. If you don't have issues with the, any of these processes, immediately within 5 minutes, your chiller will start to increase the load capacity. So we have the just summarization. First, chiller, we will give the command to the chiller. Healthy chiller will select it. We'll give the command to the chiller. Chiller will give the command to the butterfly valves for condenser line and chill water line. Once the valves are open, the primary pumps will be switched on. And in the condenser line, once the condenser line butterfly valves are open, immediately the command is given to the cooling towers valves. Once the cooling towers valves are open and condenser line valve is open, immediately the pumps will be switched on, condenser pump. If all the equipments are running without any issues, chiller will start to increase the flow. This is the process. In this process, if you have any issues with the flow or any of the equipment, within that we have for every actions, there is a, we have given a particular time, like it has to, like if we give the command to any of the equipment, we should receive the response from within 30 seconds. That is what we have configured in each equipment. So you have to receive this response from that particular equipment with fixed timing, this timing. With this, we are not getting any of the equipment, like with the valves or any of the pumps, if you are not getting within this duration, so we will consider there is some issue and we will do immediately changeover. Or we will, particular that equipment, we will consider as a lockout. Like there is something issues, and plant manager will put the lock on that particular equipment. And we will generate alarm, that particular alarm to be checked. And then if you have checked, if you rectify that particular alarm, you can come and acknowledge. The procedure of resetting the alarm or attending the alarm, we are going to discuss in the last section. This is the startup of the equipment. So I think it's clear. So we'll go for the next section. It's shutting down process.
No, one more thing. This now you're talking that the schedule of the chiller is like a weekly wise, right?
That's right.
So it is, how is calculating, like hours or mean like
day? Day and time fixed.
Day. Okay. Day and time.
There is no hours in the plan manager, so we do not consider any hours of the equipment. You have that equipment. You have options. You can see what the, how many hours the equipment are running, what is the equipment running hours to the chillers, as well as the equipment. And you have an option, you can reset that hours also for your maintenance purpose. We are going to explain that one. So but rotation will not take place based on the hours. It will just based on your weekly fixed rotation.
So it means like we have to do it in manual, it will be in automatic.
Everything automatic.
Automatic.
Everything automatic.
So in once we given that, so it means it will be automatic circulation.
In this system, the total, in the plant manager, you have to do only two things. One is resetting the alarm.
Yes.
One is, if you want to change the set point, you can change the set point. That's it.
Yes.
In auto. This is the two things only you have to do by manual. Resetting the norm, reset it. And that is also, there is a options are there which auto reset will happen, that I'm going to explain you, but it's not a fully auto process. So you have to, your operator intervention is required. So he has to go and reset the alarm. That is the only normal operation which operator has to do. Mm-hmm. Or if you want to do the changes of the set point, you can do it. If you want. This is the two things you have to do. Other than this, fine. Mm-hmm. Everything will happen automatically.
Okay, one more thing. This when you were switching on the chiller,
yeah.
So there was you mentioned that valves and these pumps and they will check the status. So it will read in the temperature as well, like cooling tower temperature in and out. It will read that one as well in chiller.
Yeah, yeah.
So see, like summer time on the chill load line, if it is okay shut down, mean like until like if it was shut down, it will like line was maybe heat.
Right.
So it will take more time to start the chiller.
That's right. That is right. There is options are there.
Yeah.
There are. Basically, if you give the complete system training, or if I can explain you, maybe
yeah.
You go for 1,000 pages of book, because this is developed. It's not like this, the logic or the plant manager, how it should operate.
Yes.
This is developed over the period of like, you know, 30, 40 years.
Okay.
From the basic one, you can say.
Yes.
From that till date, they keep on doing the updates.
Yes.
It's not like it stopped here. It's further, because this is the, what the present, the factory has recommendation.
Yes.
This is you have to do. So in maybe after 6 months, they will come up with something like, you know, you have to change this parameter, you have to do this fine tuning of this 0.5 degree of increase, so that the efficiency of the system will increase, or you can improve your energy saving. This keep on, they are doing this. Every 6 months, there is some updates will be there.
Mm-hmm.
And when till the warranty will take care of that updates or whatever the minor changes is required, we are going to do it. After that, you have to go for a maintenance contract which will cover these things. So if we will come every 3 months, we will review your system. If anything is to be done or any changes to be done, or if you see some issue with your system, we will advise you, you're doing this thing, this is wrong. You have to do this fine tuning, or this you have to change parameters. These things it will be done. Timely over the period. And timely manner we will give the advice also. Or if anything is to be done from our side, we'll do that changes. So this is how.
Is there any system that you can quick start the chiller? Like when the chiller goes off about 20 minutes, all the hotel is hot. The floor is starting sweat. Is there any system that we can quick start the chiller to run, like a bypass?
No. See, there is no quick solution for in the chillers. It's very simple. The moment you run the chillers, means you are consuming your energy. Running one chiller for a 5 or 10 minutes also, there is a huge amount of energy you are going to, you know, consume. So you should be very careful when you are running the chiller. From our also, there are a big logic is going behind that one. Before running also, we will think 100 times, is it necessary I have to run this chiller? Is it, if I run this chiller also, for the next how much hour I can run this particular chiller? Running a 15 minutes or 20 minutes, it's not a good thing for the chiller also. In chiller also, there is a restrictions. You cannot run chiller for a day, I think, more than 6 times. Switching on, switching off, switching on, switching off, you cannot do that. After, I think, 5 or 6, 8 times. There is a limitations. The moment 8 times crosses, it will lock itself. You do whatever from your wing, the carrier guys also, they cannot switch on the chillers. This is safety of the chillers. So should be very careful when you're running the chillers. We'll make sure that in our system, we'll do that one, like, if I want to run this chiller, it should run minimum for 1 hour. Minimum. Like 45 minutes to 1 hour. This is what, when we trigger the command. So seeing this, there are steps are there, very, very critical steps, which is minor steps, I'm going to explain that one, adding on the chiller. So I'll make sure if I send the command, it should run for 1 hour. Minimum 1 hour. Then only I will switch on the chiller. Otherwise I will stop. I will not switch on the chiller. So there are the requirements are there, so we have to follow that. There is like, you know, you have some there issue and you want to run the chiller here. No, you cannot do that. There is options are there, you can run it. There is a quick also for maintenance mode. There is modes are there, you can use that one, but it is not recommended. No, you should not use. So you have to check where is the problem, find it, rectify that one and then leave this one in auto operation. It will take care of itself. Okay. So this is about the startup. Then the second one is shutting down process that we can going to discuss now. Okay, this is a shutting down. Shutting down means the two choices are, or you want to shut down your plant. So how it will happen? So shutting down the plant, it's very easy. If you have a maintenance or if you have any work to do in the system and you want to run shut down the plant. So one button in the plant manager, select it. It will do as per the requirement of the system without any alarm in the system. So what will it do? It will give all the two chillers are running. There is a low load. There is a second chiller is not required to run. So the system want to take off that particular chiller from the operation. And this is the process which will follow the plant manager to cut off the chillers. So first, what will do? Once you give the command to the chiller to switch off first. The moment you give the command, chiller will start to unload. If it is like 60 or 70%, it will run percentage wise. It will start to unloading. So once the chiller is completely unloaded, what will happen? So immediately it will take like, it depends upon the capacity. If we have 40 or 50% capacity, immediately it will go like within 2 minutes. Or if it is 80% or 90%, it will take more than five, approximately five, or maybe it will go more than five. Depends upon the chiller. Chiller itself, it will decide unloading of the chiller. Basically, it will stop, give the respective pumps to it will give the command to the switch on condenser pump or primary pump. The parallelly, the valves will start to close, motorized valves, and then once the motorized valves are closed, the cooling tower or fans, it will go off. These are the processes which will follow the shutting down process. It's just like reverse. We given the command first to the chiller. Here also, we are giving the command chiller command to the chiller. Chiller will start to unload. It will start to give the command to the respective butterfly valves. Once it's off, then parallelly, immediately the condenser pump or primary pump will be switched off. That when this process is happening, it will give the command to the cooling tower also to go off. So this is the shutting down process. So I think two things are very clear. So shutting down process and the startup of the chiller. So hopefully it is clear, right? Okay. The next is how the chiller will be added. In what conditions the chiller will be added, and there is the next section is how the chiller will be subtracted. It's both are completely different. It's not like, you know, taking one parameter we will switch on the chillers. No, or taking a one parameter we are shutting down the chillers. There are a lot of parameters are there, but mainly we are using, there are when we are switching on only two parameters, but cutting off the chillers there is a three parameters. These are the very critical three parameters. Rest of the things it will not make much impact, but there is some other parameters also it will be taken into consideration. First thing is temperature. It's very important. So plant manager is designed, mainly designed, keeping in two things. One is comfort. First is comfort. First is not energy saving, first is comfort. Second is importance for us is energy saving. First, comfort means designed temperatures or designed chill water temperature or occupied space temperature. This has to be maintained. So that is the most important thing for the chiller plant manager. Once you have maintained your temperature, immediately you will think about in the how I can save now the energy saving. These are the two things which we consider or factory is considered to developing the system. So now when you have those the chillers, one chiller always it will run. There is the temperature requirement is there or not required, the chiller will never goes off. It will run. So if temperature is, your building is running with a low load, still the chiller will run, but it will like, there is a one mode, what's it called?
Recycling
mode. So it will go for recycling mode. This mode will enable when supply and return temperature, it's equal, basically. The return temperature, for example, return temperature is 7 degrees and supply temperature also 7 degrees. So immediately chiller will go for the recycling mode. Once the chiller goes recycling mode, these are the things, just I'm giving it the slightly just description of the things. This will be, you can discuss with the chiller guys, they are very expert on this modes and all. So recycling mode, it will take around 15 minutes. The once it's entered to the recycling mode, till 15 minutes, it will not switch on the chillers. And I think there is a 2 degree difference also you should get in the supply and return, or 2 or 1.5. Not sure, you can just check with the chillers. Chillers guys, they have adjusted this parameter. If this temperature deviation you get it, then only immediately the chiller will start. But in the system, it will show as a healthy running. It will not show as a chiller is on. No, the pumps, cooling towers, everything is, it will run itself. But only the chiller capacity will become zero. This is called recycling. So this is the one of the mode. And so once chiller is started, one chiller is running. Now, when we are going to add the second chiller? So this is the conditions. The first condition is, for example, we assume that your requirement is 6 degree. Like this is, for example, we are discussing for as per the project, it's a 5.5 degree is the requirement of temperature. So there is a two-step question in our system. One is which you are giving to the system. That is, for example, 5.5 or 6 degree. This is the system set point. It's called system set point. First thing. Second thing, there is an effective set point is there in the system. That is plant manager internal set point. So internal set point means we will take your set point and we will add 1.2 degree to that. So now my effective set point is 7.2. Okay? That is the internal process. So it will not make any difference for your normal operations. But you have to know this is very important triggering the chillers. You are saying my temperature is 7 degree, still the second chiller is not running. Why it is not running? This is why I am just explaining this particular thing. Effective set point. So your set point is 6, system effective set point is 7.2. Then there is a dead band of 1.2 degree will be added. This is decided by the factory based on the manufacturing of the chiller. They have decided 1.2 degree can be achieved with the existing chiller, the running chiller. Whichever you are running with a 90% capacity. But still there is a 10% capacity you are not using. Using that 10%, easily you can achieve. For example, I am just giving for example, 1.2 degree. That is why whenever you are running the chiller, like given the set point of 6, till 7.2, there is no action will take place. System will try to maintain the supply temperature of 6 degree using that particular running chiller itself. Straight? There is a no action will take place till 7.2. Set point. Okay. Now assume that you have set your system as a supply temperature of 6 degree. Now supply temperature will start to increase. Goes. Till 7.2 will not take any action. Will try to maintain the temperature with existing chiller. We will request the chiller to increase its capacity or balance itself or to the giving the better condensing temperature. We will try to maintain the supply temperature of 6 degree. If still the chiller, now what happened? The chiller, we tried all the options, the chiller is running with 100% capacity. Now the chiller is running with 100% capacity. So we will monitor that temperature. We'll below this temperature also we'll monitor. Above this temperature, we'll start it to trend this temperature and we will observe it how the temperature will react. For example, 7.2 above, we will start to monitor for the period of 15 minutes, 10 minutes. We have given this particular minute, the system 10 minutes. So we will monitor 10 minutes. The 10 minutes, the temperature of the supply, temperature should be above 7.2. If this temperature drops below 7.2, at the last moment of this timer, like 9th minute also, we will just reset, we will just observe once again this temperature for the next 10 minutes. Maybe your existing chiller will try to maintain the set point of 6 degree. So maybe your load is reducing in the system. So that's why we will just monitor it, and then if the temperature is dropping below, we will just wait for another 10 minutes. The reaction of the supply temperature. Okay, so what will happen? Now the load side temperature started to increase above 7.2. After 10 minutes, like before 10 minutes, it's dropped once again 7.2. So we have stopped once again monitoring the temperature. So after 10 minutes, once again it started to increase the supply temperature. It goes above 7.2. Okay, next. So temperature, now in this condition what is happened? The supply temperature remains for the all over the 10 minutes of period above the set point, effective set point, that is 7.2. So once the temperature is now stable and above the effective set point, now the second chiller will be switched off. This is how the chiller will be added.
So what will be the chiller to set point? Is it 5.5 or it's 7?
6.
6. Same.
Yes. Whatever you are entering in your system, the set point, that same set point immediately sent to the chillers. The chillers will try to maintain 6 degrees, not 7.2. But actions in the plant manager will be taken based on the effective set points. So it's very clear. Right? Adding. This is adding. Next we will go for the subtraction. Now, adding chiller, it's the same steps it will be followed. Add chiller, aspiration valve will open, pumps will start, flow will be established to the condenser and chill water line of the chiller, and chiller will be started. Stopping the chiller, it's a subtraction of the chillers. It's the same. In these conditions, we are taking the three most important conditions here when we are subtracting. That is what I told you. We should not. We will not switch on the chillers by half an hour or once you will start, switch off, we will not do that one. For avoiding that one, these are the conditions very important to monitor. So, when you are switching off the chillers, now for example, you started two chillers. Now, load is reduced in the building, now we want to cut off one of the chillers. So, when you are cutting off the chillers, means your load is less. For example, two chillers are running, it's maintained the temperature, now it is started to reduce. Reduce means it's come around 45% of the chillers. Then plant, both the chillers are running below 45%. It should be. Then only the chiller will be removed from the operations. In this case, we assume that chillers are running below 45% capacity. So, both the chillers, once it goes below 45% of capacity, will wait for 10 minutes. In this, once again 10 minutes, the chiller capacity should not go above 45%. The moment it goes above 45% means still we'll assume that your chiller load is not stable, or maybe it will increase your load side, the load requirement is there, so we'll just wait another 10 minutes maybe. So if your capacity is continuously below the 10 minutes, so we'll wait that around 10 minutes, the capacity is lesser than that, so immediately the first we'll assume that now the chiller is not required, one of the chillers, but still we will not take from the operation. Second condition, there is one more condition is the supply temperature. In addition, we added effective set point like 6 degree plus 1.2. In subtraction, we will add 0.6. 6 degree plus 0.6. So effective set point for subtraction is 6.6. Right? This is the effect. The supply temperature should be lesser than 6.6. This is over the period of 10 minutes. This is the second condition. So these two conditions are continuously met for over the period of 10 minutes. 10 minutes, these two conditions to be true. In between, there is any deviation with these two conditions, like one of the conditions is not met, immediately we will wait for another 10 minutes. Assuming that your load is not stable, or maybe load may be in the load side, maybe you are further calling the load, like there is a heat requirement is there. So we'll assume it and we'll wait for 10 minutes. In this duration of 10 minutes, the temperature is less, immediately the chiller will be cut off. Second chiller. So this is how the subtraction will take place. These conditions are clearly mentioned in your training manual, so you can see this one. So this is the three conditions. First is load. Load should be below 50. Second, supply temperature should be lesser than the effective set point. Third, over the 10 minutes, we will wait for the temperatures. These two conditions. This is about the subtraction of the chillers. Stopping the chiller, valves will close, condenser valve and flow switch, the condenser side and the evaporator side, the flow will be stopped, the primary pump will goes off. So this is how the process of stopping. So this is about the plant chillers, how the chillers will be added, subtracted. So we have almost finished 80% of our important topics, we can say. Next is the primary pump and condenser pump. So if you have any questions or any, first we can discuss it. Because now we have just a standard operation of condenser pump or primary pumps. Okay. So we'll go to the primary pump. Primary pumps, so chillers, how many chillers are running? So many pumps will run. If one chiller is running, one primary pump will run. Two chillers are running, two primary pumps will run. If any pumps are failed, immediately the standby pumps will run. This is about the primary pumps. Condenser pump is the same thing. Chillers, how many chillers are running? Same numbers of pumps will run. If one chiller, one pump. Two pumps, two chillers, two pumps. If there is any failure of pump, rotation or next available pumps will run. But when you are running the available pumps also, both will happen. The moment it's off, immediately it will run. For the like 30 seconds or 40 seconds, maybe all the three pumps will run, maybe. Because we should not have more variation in the flow for the chillers. Maybe you will get in full load conditions if there is any variation, so maybe the chillers will go in alarm. So to avoid that one, maybe for the 30 or 40 seconds, maybe like if two pumps are running, one of the pump is strict or one of the pump is put it in manual or over the period of changeover, maybe you will have 30 minutes or 40 seconds. Three pumps will run, but immediately it will be switched off. Cooling towers, the number of chillers, number of cooling towers will run. One chiller, one cooling tower. But if there is a high temperature in the condenser side, maybe the second cooling tower will run, but condenser pumps, only one pump will run. With one pump, two cooling towers, there is a chance of running if your temperature is not maintained, condenser in temperature is not maintained. In that condition, the second additional cooling tower will be switched off. The temperature, the cooling tower fan will, speed will moderate it based on the outlet temperature of the cooling towers. This is how the cooling tower will work.
But all fans will run?
It depends. If the condenser temperature is lesser than 24 degree, so pump fan will switch off. Like winter, extreme winter, snowy, so condenser temperature is maintained, so immediately the fan will switch off. Only you will have circulation, so water circulation. In that condition, extreme. Conditions, or when you are starting, it will run with the two fans. Then required only the middle fan will run. Always the two fans will run, the last two fans, and then middle fan. You have a three fans in the cooling tower.
Yeah.
So middle fan. Once these two fans are running with, when it is reaching a 90%, then only the middle fan will run. If there is a requirement, otherwise it will try to avoid the one of the fan. But two fans always. This is about the cooling towers. So the next section is. Graphics. So, I'm not taking much more time. So, this is how this is the layout of the plant. All the important information. What is required for the operator? It will be displayed here. So you can view in this screen. Always you have to monitor this screen. Whatever if you have any alarm alerts or any barcodes. Will immediately give the indications here. Okay, this is the graphics is called chiller here. So there is a before that two slides are there. Basically, it's not here. There is a login page. With the login page, you have the login privileges. So based on like operator, there is an engineer. Operator will have a basic one. He can only reset it, or we can put the equipment in the manual, or acknowledge the alarm, or change the set point. This is all for the operator. And there is a one more level is engineer, which will have all the admin rights. You can change, you can generate the reports, you can change the system settings, you can logs, you can change, you can delete alarms. These are the things that can be done through the admin rights. So these are the two rights we have. So once you run your system, so there is a two applications, one application you have to run, that is called server. So you have to run your PC, then run the server. Its two icons are there in the desktop. One is server, one is login page. So server, double click it, it will run, you have to just wait it. Once the server is running, automatically it will minimize. The moment it is minimized, then there is a login page is there, double click it, put your privileges, login to the system. Once you log in, it will take you to the main page directly. And from there, you will have it in the site. This is the separate page, drop down option. With all the equipments, you can find it here. All of the equipments are connected. You can go and select the individual equipments. This is about the login, how you can log in. In the top side, you have some of the standard options. Okay. You have a graphics, that's the top. and then properties, alarms, trend, logic and reporting. So in this graphics, the customized graphics as per your requirement, what are the options we have provided, we have given here. And second, properties, this is the property of the parameters which will you are not going to use operator level or engineer level, it will not help you much more. For us, for configuration purpose is very important. Then alarm, if you select that particular alarm tab, whatever the alarms are generated from this particular equipment, you can find it in that particular tab, alarms. Next to alarm, that particular equipment, this particular equipment, if there is any alarm in the primary pump, it will not show you in that tab. You have to go to there is a last, there is a red triangle indication is there. That is the common alarm. Whatever alarms are generating in the system, it will be logged in that particular tab. So you can find all the alarms. This is individual equipment alarm. And then there is a trend switch there. Whatever the trends are configured, you can see on that particular tab. The important trends, we have given the graphic itself. Just click it, you can find it in a big page. Or there are other parameters out there, that is also you can view it through that option. Just go drop down the trend and you can select which parameter you want to monitor, the start stop or run status, or there is an alarm trend you want to monitor, you can monitor it from that one. And then logic, that is an important option which is available in our system. Compared to other system, you will not find that option. The end client or operator can view what is happening inside the DC controller. So whatever we have done the programming, you can find it there. Live, which is giving the command, there is an alarm, everything you can find it inside the controller, what is happening from that tab. So if you have a knowledge about, at least basic knowledge about the programming, or it's not a C++ like programming, it's a live programming, you can easily understand. If you have a basic knowledge about the gates, so we can understand what is happening inside the controller. That's the best option which is feature is available in our system. Then reports, there are standards, customized reports if you want, you can do it. Or there is a standard reports we have created, you can access and you can generate monthly wise, weekly wise or day wise reports, you can do it from there. There is a last option, is that there is a best option which is available, which is showing a small circle. Can you just point it out that one? Yeah. Time logs option. Okay. Next to the printer option, there is a triangle alarm is there. Next to that one, there is a printer. Next to that one, there is a round circle, you can see. This is the best options. So what will happen is, all the trend parameters, everything will be saved in the system. You are in the morning section, something is happening in the night section. You want to know what is happening. The normal way, what you will do, you will go alarm and check what is happening, when it is, what is there. But in this option, you can rewind your graphics and you can monitor, like movie. You rewind your movie and see what is happening in the past. Same thing you can do it. This complete graphic will be displayed in that. You can select it when, for what time, to what time you want to monitor what happened in this graphics, particular graphics. And you can do it from that. So status, what is happening, when the status is drawn, when the chiller is started, what temperature was at that time, what actions has taken place here. Everything it will be recorded. Like it's a, just like a movie. Just rewind it, see what is happening in the particular duration. That is called time lapse option. Okay. The next one, the print, just view, there is a printer itself, there is a printer, so whatever the graphics if you want or reports, you can use that option and you can generate the print. Alarm, all the alarm related to this project or the system, all the logged in that particular alarm. So if there is an alarm, you have to check the alarm, rectify it, come back, acknowledge it. Help, there is a complete help for the software or options is available. Offline, so you can go search with whatever you are required, so you will find it there in that help option. There is a last option is there, that is a drop down option. In that option, there is a two things that are very, very important. You have to take, one is log off, after your operation, you have to log off from the system. Second is, there is a called mod start. So if any you have issues, like it's not working, so you want to know what is happening, I mean, you have to start somewhere to troubleshoot. The first way is select it, mod start, you have to select it. If you select, the moment you select the mod start option, you will get a small window saying mod start. Mod start means module status. Enter it, the moment you enter it, you will get a screen. So, if you have issues, when you call us, I'm feeling that I have these issues, I'm not getting the rating. Then we will say the first check, do the mod start. You have to just go there, mod start it. Once you mod start it, you will get one full page. In that particular page, you will get a lot of information. Like, if you get there is a lot of information in that particular page, means your controller is healthy and it is communicating with the system. and there is a running program. It will give how many programs are there inside the controller and how many programs are running. That is also very important, because there is a backup battery there in the controller. Maybe someone goes and then they take on this battery, means there is a the saved program inside the controller, it will reset. So if it is reset means it will not work. But to reload that program, it's very important. You call us, we will guide you the step by step how to do that one. All the information it will be saved in the PC itself. Just select it, download it, you can get once again the plant into auto operation. This is about the how to just check the communications basically. Second, this is the most options you can see. All other equipments also same or no same. So if you have like particularly the chillers, this is the chiller sequencer. Whatever the chiller, as a plant, the plant manager, the most critical process will happen in this particular controller or in the particular section. Adding, subtracting, everything it will happen. Then this information will be sent to the primary pump or condenser pump or cooling towers. So this is the lag. First tab you can see a lead lag sequence, that is which is the chiller one is the lead, or which is the lead chiller, which is the lag chiller. It will give every week this will rotate based on your schedule. This will rotate. It's now it is showing chiller one is 1, chiller 2 is 2. Next week chiller 2 become 1 and chiller 1 become 2. This is the rotation what we discussed previously. Then auto, if you running your chillers in auto, it will be the indication, auto indication. Then you will get a butterfly valve command, butterfly valve status, evaporator come butterfly valve command status, chiller command, chiller run status, alarm. If any alarm occurs in the equipment, you will get indications here. Alarm orange light, it will give the indication, say there is an alarm in the equipment. There is a logo. If any malfunctioning or if any actions we feel that plant manager, there is a, something is not standard or something is creating issue for the operation, immediately that equipment will put it in lockout. Lockout means it's a just lockout. So, and we will generate the what is the issue about that particular issue, we will generate an alarm. So, you have to check that alarm, you have to attend it, and then you can come and reset it. Resetting, lockout here. If anything is happened in your system, tripping, or it is not giving a status, or it not giving the feedback, immediately it will give as that particular alarm and it will go for lockout. Lockout comes, you have to go to that particular equipment, attend it, reset that alarm in the equipment, come back and you have to acknowledge. Acknowledging means your lockout clear, you have to do it clear. The moment you do the lockout clear means you are acknowledging that you have attended the problem and you have rectified. So then only that particular equipment it will be added to the operation. Till that it will be taken as a faulty one. This is about the logout or alarm, how to attend the alarm. Maintenance override command, this is what we have discussed. In case you want to run or you want to test your chillers, it's running or not. For maintenance purpose. It is not for like, you know, your temperature is not maintaining in the building, come and switch it on to the manual mode. No, it's not like that. For that purpose, it is not provided. Maintenance mode, we are giving directly command to the equipment with bypassing some of the safety circuits. So, always it is not recommended to run the system in maintenance command. Don't use it. It is for testing purpose. What is the use of this then? The main thing is you have some issue with your chiller. Keep on tripping. You brought our guys, service guys, they have tested. Maybe that is the lag chiller. So you cannot run it. You can run it manually, you can test it, but you want to make sure that after rectification of that people, it is running in auto or no. For that purpose, we have provided this one. So they have rectified, put it everything in auto. The second chiller is this week is not running. So go and maintenance override command. Put it on and what action to require. You want to put it off or you want to put it on. Select it just. Put it on, it will run. Run for 10 minutes, 15 minutes, you stay there, monitor the system, or if once you are okay with your working of the chillers, just put it off. Put it off maintenance override command. That's it. Whenever you are running the chiller in maintenance override command, always it will give as alarm, saying that you are not doing a standard operation. So it will always give as alarm indication. So that is the purpose of we have provided. Second option is, chiller 1 is lead, you are running, you want to do the maintenance. Or there is some abnormal sound is there in the chiller and you want to put it out. How are you going to put it out? Just use the manual maintenance command, put it on that particular chiller. The moment you put it on that particular running chiller, immediately it will give the command to the second chiller. This is how it will happen. So this is the purpose why we have provided the maintenance command. Okay?
How many of them you can tell the chiller from week?
Sorry?
How many of them you can tell the chiller for maintenance command?
Like how many times?
Yeah.
You can take, but per day, I think you cannot go more than 6 times. That is what the chiller. That's it. 6 times you can go per day. That is normal on off or maintenance command,
week.
Any command.
Per week.
Per week multiply by 7. But it's a day wise, it will calculate always day wise, not week wise. 6 means 6, that's it, per day. If you are accessing 6 days, that will be, the chiller will be switched off. Right? Yes. Okay, that's about the sequencer. So we'll go for the individual chillers. You have all the individual chillers, which is critical parameter, which is helpful for the operation of the system. You can monitor. We'll go next, which is in the last slide. So we'll go for the primary pump. Primary pump, same options, everything you can see, read like sequence, weekly, it will change rotation, command is there, run status is there, lift status, locker status, most of things, all the operation, all the options are same. Here you can find it, there is the two things are there. One is run hours. This is what I have explained you about the run hours. This is the one here. This is for maintenance purpose we have provided. If you want, you can reset it, this one, this maintenance hour, to keep the track. So you have did the maintenance and you want to do the maintenance for after 500 hours or 1000 hours, you want to monitor it, you can do this one. You can see from here, do the maintenance, reset it. The moment you reset it, the reset date will be displayed. This particular date, it's equal, this 1 hour resetted. And then from that date, it will start to count the run hours. And equalization of the run hour also, you can monitor from here. So it is equalization will be done from now. It's 99% it will be done here.
Is it also keeping the total hours? Let's say if you come and check after 10 years, you will be able to find out how many hours?
Yeah, if you are, and as far as if you are not
or
resetting,
you have not reset.
You have not reset. That's it. And
so
then you can keep the
track. It's not keeping the total as well.
No, we are not giving for this option for the equipment. But chillers you have. Chillers, there is a, if you go to a particular individual chiller, you will find it. You cannot do the reset of that one.
No.
There is two options are available in the chiller. In the chiller, internal run hours you can find it. It cannot be reset. Maybe you have some issue with the software or resetting the software. Maybe it will happen. It will reset to zero. Otherwise, it will remain the same. But in the sequencer also, you can find the same option. You can reset it or you can monitor it. This is what main basically it is provided for the maintenance purpose. So you want to keep the track or you want to observe it operation of the system. So you can make it less of that one. Second thing is, it will display what is the requirement. The last section you can see the demand, how much pumps to be run based on your requirement. That will be displayed in the last column. Just mark it that one. Two is there. That is what it is giving. Two chillers are running in this when we take the screenshot, and two pumps are running. In that downside, just downside, you can see the Monday. So that is the day which is selected for the rotation of the equipment. So you can select it and then define the hours. What hour you want to run this rotation? So put it there and then it will be rotated every week based on that hours. And second, there is manual rotation also, you can do it. There is a blue color button is there. The moment you press that manual rotation, it will increase one rotation. If you want to do manual, you can do that. And there is a thing is that there is two chillers are there. One chiller is having a good efficiency. You are saying that or you want to run, there is some issue with the second chiller. So you want to run the first chiller for the next 15 days or 1 month. You don't want to do the rotation of the automatic. So you can fix the rotation also. You have to select as a change rotation. Yes, you have to make and you select the rotation. Which chiller you want to run? Lead chiller, the first, as a first chiller. One or two, just select it. Based on that, it will run that particular chiller till you select no. So if you make it no, it will go for auto operation. If you make it yes, it will go for that particular sequence. So this is the sequence about the sequence. So next. Okay, cooling towers, almost everything is the same options. Main thing is about the resetting of the alarm. If you get the alarm in the chillers or any of the equipment, to give the indication alarm here, go to the equipment, observe the equipment, for example, maybe noise or maybe leakage. These are things visually you have to observe it and reset in that equipment. You have to go to the equipment, reset it. Come back and then acknowledge, reset it here, it will automatically it will add it into the operations. If you are not resetting here, you, for example, you, there is an alarm in the chillers, you went through the alarm to the chiller and you reset it. And you didn't reset for the 10 minutes. For that 10 minutes, the system will observe, there is an, if you don't have any issues, automatically the plant manager will reset. Automatically it will happen. But it will happen 3 days, 3 times per day. For 24 hours, 3 times auto reset will happen. After that, it will completely lock from here. The operator has to come and reset. So this is the option also, it's available in the system. Auto reset for all the equipment. It will wait for 10 minutes. Okay. This is about, so you have a set point here, you can adjust it, cooling tower set point, whatever the living temperature of the cooling tower settings you want to change, you can change it to this one. And then the cooling towers will maintain that temperature, modulating the VFDs, and you will get a VFD feedback also here. So, what's this about the cooling towers? Okay. Outside air conditions, conditions you can monitor here. What is the high temperature? What is the low temperature? What is your current temperature? Humidity, everything you will monitor, as well as you will get a trend, or you will get all the logs here. So you can and you can for your references you can view it. This one. Second. Temperature. This is the trend I shown for example. So you have a trend. So you can select it, whichever trend you want, and then just select the trend and just drag. So you can zoom in, zoom out, drag the trend, so you can view it. Or if you want to copy to the Excel, just copy CVC text and then paste it to the Excel. You will get all the trend samples to the Excel also. Or if you want to take the reports in the PDF or Excel, you can take the reports of the all the trends. Alarm, this is the alarm section. I told you in the last section, if you go and select it, that alarm, so it will display like this. So you will get it. All the alarms with the timestamp and description about the problems. So particular problem, once alarms comes, you have to check it. If you have to acknowledge from this place, basically, the alarms. And then if you want to keep this record, you can keep it, or if you want to delete it using the engineering password, you can delete it. So all the information will be displayed here. Whatever the actions will take place, all the actions will be logged here. So this is about the alarm tab. So I'm going to finish up with the plant manager. So any questions, any doubts? Last, not the least thing, equipment standby, there is a standby equipment out there. Standby means always it should be healthy. It is not like you have a fault and you put it in the standby. No, standby equipment should be always, it's in the auto and it should be in healthy conditions. Because there is a logic out there, if anything is happened, immediately it will take over, the standby will take over the faulty one. So make sure that all the equipments should be in the healthy conditions, always. That is the one. Second thing, don't run the planting manual. So I have explained almost all the major topic I have covered, but there are a lot of things behind this take space which will, you cannot do it in a manual mode. So it's very important. So put it in auto, everything will take care of with the system.
Let's say we have three primary. Okay. So one is a standby.
Right.
This means a specific one is always standby.
No. It's always rotate.
All of them rotate.
That's right. That's right. All every week it will rotate. That is what with the rotation.
All three of them.
Okay. It will rotate. So this week the pump 1, 2, 3 is the first. So next week the pump 2 will be the leading. The third week the pump 3 will be the leading one. So it will keep on rotating now. So this is about the plant manager.
Yeah. The standby fault. Is it the transient
fault or natural fault? No, I
didn't get started. The standby fault.
Okay.
Is it transient fault or normal fault? Is it fault in the machine or let's say there is a phase that is being changed?
There is two types of faults. One is from the machine itself you will get it. While there is a VFD there, so we'll get it alarm in the VFD. So that is the alarm. That is the equipment, physical fault. Second alarm, I will give the command to the pump, but it will not run. There is some problem, or it is not started within 30 seconds. So I will generate one alarm that I given the command, I didn't get a response. So that is called lockout or fail to start alarm. That is a virtual alarm I have created because I didn't get the feedback from the pump. So this is the another category. So different category, but if you go to the description of the alarms, you'll find it. It will be clearly written what exactly alarm it is. So based on that, you can understand very easily and you can attend that particular alarm. Chillers also, our senior guy is going to give the about the chillers. But if you have the alarms, if you get the alarms, you just check minor alarms, it's okay. You can, if you know that particular alarm, you can reset it. Or if you don't know the alarm, please contact with our technical persons or maintenance guys. Take a feedback and then you can reset it. So.
And sorry, one more thing. This there is one option for the remind, like rapid remind, right?
Time
so,
lapse.
Yeah, how many period we can like?
3 months. We kept as a three months of you can remind and we can see. Basically, it's a trend we have configured. And some parameters, if you require a critical parameters, you can extend to 1 year also. Some supply temperature intel we have done for 1 year, but normally we kept it for 3 months because that much of data will be locked in the system.
Yeah.
Your database will be very huge after over the 1 period or 1 year or 2 years. So we are eliminating this one. So normally we will use for 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
3 months data you can
have.
Okay. Operation in the training manual, how you can check the set points, everything is very detailed, resetting step by step, it is there. So you can go through that one. If you have any concerns or if you have any doubts, when you're in the operation also, you can reach us or my colleagues, there's something you can call at any time. So we will be happy to support you.
So I will, from here, I will go to the front room to check the sensors.